Welcome to another episode of As Real As They Come. I'm Jennifer Loading.
Yulia Brown.
And we are here at the Turkish Cafe in Plano. And so before we get started, we want to tell you to hit the subscribe button on YouTube. And so, Yulia, who do we have here today with us?
Well, we've got Mr. Gary Toll, an ordinary man with extraordinary story.
Oh, that's awesome. I love that intro.
Thank you.
That was like really good. Yeah. That's good. An ordinary man with an extraordinary
like
story.
You are somebody.
We like extraordinary stories.
Well, cool.
They give you character, right?
Mm-hmm. I believe that's true.
That is true. I agree with you.
Give you character, give you hope, give you inspiration, you name it.
Yeah. Yes, and he has an amazing story of just, I think, almost just survival.
Pretty much.
So I think incredible story. So
it's chain of events.
Yeah.
Chain of almost like that story, chain of unfortunate events,
yeah.
Which actually brought you to who you are today.
Yeah, when you have friends that say, you know, when I think of you, I think of Job, the Bible character.
Oh, wow.
I don't know what to say.
Yeah, wow.
Thanks for thinking of me.
That's awesome.
I don't even know where to start because you got the IPF. We'd like to talk about that.
Okay.
We'd like to talk about your incredible journey with the Holy Spirit.
Okay. I think that's a great place to jump in.
Yeah, let's jump in. Start there. Just kind of walk us through that and tell us, you know, a little bit about you and mm-hmm. how all this came about for you.
My elevator speech.
No. Yes. I don't know if it's quite elevator, but
life
it's a little more
powerful.
Yeah, it's a little more,
a little more powerful than that.
It might be a little more powerful than that.
Well, this is it's a real opportunity, and to be here with you both.
Thank you.
I can't tell you how much I appreciate the invitation.
It's a true honor to have you.
Well, thank you very much. I'm going to just speak from the heart and let you know where it all came about. I am just 50 or 67 years old as of last week. I've been married for 42 years.
Happy belated birthday.
Thank you.
And impressive on the 42 years. Yay, that deserves a round of applause. Yes, especially in today's society, for sure.
Six grown kids.
Wow.
One married, but no grandkids. But there you go.
Yet.
So I was a business person my whole career. I love business. I've had startup companies of my own. I've worked in various fields from computer products to industrial construction, supply material, and the things in between. Real estate, I've taught for the Online Trading Academy. I've done a variety of things, but it's all been hyper-focused in, I've stayed in my lane, if you will. So life was going along, and at one point, I was with my youngest daughter, Kelsey, and the second youngest daughter, Janelle. We had moved her out to an apartment in Colorado, and we were skiing. And I love to ski. I love to ski fast. And I realized that something was drastically wrong. Not even into the run 3 to 5 minutes, I was completely winded.
Mm.
I mean, literally. And I thought, oh my goodness. I said, I can't be that out of shape. And
right.
I certainly didn't think I was getting that old. But I thought, oh, okay, you know, this is kind of bad.
Yeah.
And things like that started to happen more frequently than I was expecting. Well, I developed a cough, an incessant dry cough, which is one of the symptoms of IPF, which for those who don't know that acronym, it's idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis.
Okay.
IPF is a... it's a lethal disease. It can be of unknown origin, which is why it's idiopathic.
Yeah.
And in my case, it was familial idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. My mother had the disease in 1987 and died from IPF. So I was not unfamiliar, or I should say I was familiar enough about the disease to realize that I may have a real problem on my hands.
You're suffocating alive.
Yes, very much so.
It's scarring inside of your lungs,
mm-hmm.
which shrinks the capacity of
your oxygen saturation goes down, and it's unpredictable. Some people can have IPF for a while, and some, in my mother's case, she passed away 9 months from her diagnosis.
Wow.
She died in my arms with family around, and so I saw how it ends, and it's not pleasant at all. So I went to a variety of doctors, and I had some tests and this, that, and the other. And then, coincidentally, it was on my birthday in 2012 that I went and had a CAT scan, and it was determined that, yes, in fact, I did have idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. So now my whole thought process about life had begun to have to change because I was becoming more and more less able to do things, in so much that by 2013 our son Stephen took a year off of his life to stay at home to make sure I stayed alive. I was on a 10-liter concentrator, electric, you know, motor driven concentrator, but even that I could desaturate in just a second. And I would go so deeply into oxygen starvation that he would have to administer another 25-liter on top of that, wow. And then even another 25-liter on top of that, just so I could get enough air to breathe again. And it was horrific to go through that. But God bless him. I mean, he literally kept me from dying.
Yeah.
And what they do in a situation where you're this ill is the only thing that will help. They can give you all kinds of medication, mostly steroids in the early stages, to keep you going. But if you're healthy enough and you're willing enough and a suitable donor comes along, you are able to be put on the lung transplant list.
Okay.
But you have to become ill enough to qualify to be on the transplant list. So that was what really was really the most difficult part of it in terms of just the wait. And then
talking about fine line.
In February of 2014, I felt that I was no longer safe at home. I will only describe it to you as this, that I felt like I was underwater looking up, and I couldn't breathe, and I couldn't get to the surface of the water. And it was
I
just...
I can only imagine.
I thought it was the end.
It's a living nightmare.
Yeah.
I thought it was the end. Yeah. And my family got a caravan. We had three cars. The lead car was to run red lights, I suppose, and block traffic or whatever. My family's highly motivated.
Yeah.
And
you are loved, that's for sure.
Thank you. I do feel blessed. And so we made a beeline down to St. Paul's Hospital, which has been torn down, which kind of bummer, but that's where my transplant took place. But we got there, and I went in February, and all told, I didn't come out of the hospital until Mother's Day of that year.
Wow.
So that was the beginning of my story, if you will. And so I'm putting pen to paper, and I've decided that I want to share my story and the details of my story to those who are facing adverse medical situations, whether they be lethal, whether they be a terminal illness, or a life-threatening illness, or potentially just situational. Life happens
to
all
of
us.
Yeah,
and sometimes you feel the most deep, dark moments of despair. You don't have to be in a coma. I mean, you don't have to know that, you know, you may only have, you know, 5-10, you know, months left to live. In my case, as I mentioned, my mom died 9 months from her diagnosis. I only made it 18 months. And I was so sick that they placed me in a coma, and they said, well, lungs will come. Okay, don't worry about it, lungs will come. Well, 3 days went by, and there were no lungs. And then lungs arrived, but somebody was sicker than me.
So they
got the lungs. And so, and usually they only give you one. I was fortunate I got two. And so lungs can come, and they throw them away. Only 15% of the lungs that they receive are viable.
Oh my goodness! Wow.
Because it's not a hard organ like a heart or a kidney, if you will. Yeah. It's like if you took all the things that transfer the oxygen in your lungs,
sure,
it would cover two tennis courts. That's how much oxygen transfer material are in our lungs. It's just amazing what you learn about this just as a course of being part of it all.
Right.
So anyway, I became so sick in the hospital that while I was in a coma, it got to be too late in the cycle of things, and they told my wife that they were going to remove me from the transplant list, that I was too sick and I would not live.
Your family went through
I'm just imagining, like, that's what I'm trying to think right now, is what the torment for the just for the family going through this whole process.
They're troopers.
Wow.
Well, it was such a thing that I wouldn't ever want to do it again, but you couldn't give me $1 billion or something like that, you know, and whatever the saying is.
Wouldn't
I'm sorry.
Do it again if you pay me $1 billion.
Yeah. But I wouldn't trade anything to have gone through it. And I know it sounds very, very macabre, but it's the way it is. But if I can share with you, a lot happened during my coma, which really, it was actually during my coma that I decided to write a book.
Mm.
During the coma, not after, during.
Yeah.
So when you're intubated, they put the tube down your throat. So I wasn't just asleep, I was immobilized, and I was so near death, they couldn't even feed me, because even the function of digesting food would cause me to desaturate. So I got no food. I did get some saline. I know that for a fact now. But I was never that hungry in my entire life, nor was I that thirsty. That's the type of awareness that people can have. So as your audience is listening to this, it is so critically important that you talk to the person who's in that state, and that you don't let negative things happen that they hear and maybe give up hope. Because you might hear, oh, there's no lungs. And you're lying there and you're going, first of all, you're in there's no color. It's just, I can't even say it's black, because there's no color. There's nothing there.
Wow.
And there's no dimension. You're just, you're still a being. And lovely music. So, right on cue.
Yes.
So, the unique thing about it is that you're in this void. And to my mind, I realized only because I was hungry and thirsty that I was still alive.
Mm.
And then a terror like no other terror has ever come over me like this. I thought, what if they think I'm dead? Is this death? Oh my God, is this how I'm going to be forever? And I just was, I thought, well, I don't believe I was right. Or, was I lied to? And you're just, well, you're all alone.
So
you have plenty of time to argue with yourself and ask questions.
Wow.
And so then I thought, the most horrible thing, I thought, what if they take me to the morgue? And I'm still
here. You're still there.
And that I'm helpless. I can't do a thing about it. And I didn't know where my family was. I didn't know where I was at that point. Because after they intubate you, it's game over. You're down. And lungs are not coming. I hear people crying. I think I heard somebody say, oh, he's never going to see us get married. He's never going to see grandchildren.
Oh,
and I'm like, I'm trying
You're
to
like,
wait.
I'm here.
Yes.
Like, I'm here.
It was just everything I wanted to do, just to be awake and to prove it. And so they told me after the fact that they came in and played some music that I love, choir music from Prestonwood. And I sang there for 15 years.
Okay.
And all of a sudden, the children told me that someone from the hospital came in, I think it might have been a nurse, said, "Turn that off." And my kids are like, "He loves this kind of music, you know?" And she, "No, he's trying to wake up." You know, because I'm just in my head, I'm singing along and just having a great time. And it was like, finally I can hear something, you know? And so they turned it off, and I was very unhappy about that, I would tell you. So what did I do? I started singing in my head. And I know hundreds and hundreds of songs, both, you know, rock and contemporary, and also, you know, Christian music. And by the way, the book is for anyone, no matter if you believe in God or you don't believe in God. It's for people on a much broader scale than that. But my story happens to be very personal.
Sure.
And it's my story, and it has a lot to do with God. So this is all going on in the background, and I'm singing and I'm praying, and I got into a one-on-one conversation with the Holy Spirit. Now that in and of itself is a statement that you go, let me think about that. Let me think. Now the onus is on me, right? Yeah. Now people are going to say, "Oh, okay, mister." And it was the most believable and the most real and the most authentic experience I've ever had in my life. And so I was comforted, and I was conversational with God, and we talked about everything. I mean, everything. And at one point, the Holy Spirit asked me, he said, "Do you want to stay or do you want to go?" And I said, "You mean breathe my last breath, go?" And he said, "Yes." And I said, "I gotta think about that." And so I did. I thought about every aspect of my life to whatever degree I was able to do. I mean, there was not a moment, I think, in my life that wasn't examined. The good and the bad and the ugly. And then at one point, I recall there was my life, and it was more or less like thumbnails, if you will. And at first it was on the right side, and then it was just like that. And there was pictures of my life. And then all of a sudden it was another one on here, and they're both going like, and I'm thinking, oh my God. I said, two things in my mind. I said, either that's the real deal, and you do see your life flash before you like flashcards, and that's what's happening, and I'm dying for sure. No questions asked. I know where I'm at, right? Yeah. And meaning that I'm sick. And, or these are brain cells dying, and this is what happens when brain cells die.
Mm.
And so, either way, I might as well enjoy it. So, I'm thinking, well, okay.
It's like, go big or go home, yeah, Texas style.
I couldn't do anything about it. You could say I bought my ticket. Yeah. You know, I'm going to see the show. So, I watched this whole thing going on, and it was to a point where I said, I really want to stay. And the most unbelievable thing I could even imagine, the Holy Spirit said, "Why?" Oh my God.
Yeah.
Why? I just thought about everything, the show, I thought about everything I could possibly think about to even make that statement, right? So now I do it all over again. And I'm thinking about everything again, just in case I missed anything, right? And at the end of all of this, there was two more, but two very distinct events. One, my body was trapped inside of a life-size pinball machine. Now, that's, you know, whether you believe that or not, it happened. In my mind, it happened. So as I'm lying there, it was an old pinball machine. It wasn't like modern day, you know, it had the flippers and all the lights that go like that and the scoreboard that, you know, doing all that kind of a thing. It was sort of operational. And I'm lying there and I have a view of all of this stuff. And then all of a sudden there was a tin hand, and it was about, it's white, right? And it was on a long rusty rod. Mm-hmm. And like this table, it had worked so many years that it had worn through the top, right? And it was all patina because it was old, but this had made its mark, right? So I'm lying there, and all of a sudden the hand became animated and started moving. And I'm watching it, and there's nothing out there. But then all of a sudden I saw my watch. This is so strange. And the tin hand became real, or mechanical, just moved, grabbed the watch. When it pulled back, it went, and it went right through the hole. It hadn't even been there. It was like a pinball trap hole, right? So it just went, and I said, oh, somebody stole my watch. And I'm thinking, no, you don't wear your watch to the hospital. So I'm lying there and just not doing anything. I'm in the pinball machine. And then all of a sudden, the hand starts moving again. Now, believe it or not, there's a Snickers bar. And I'm like, I am so hungry. They hadn't fed me anything. And I'd never been that agonizingly hungry before in my entire life. I was starving to death. And the hand took its ride up to it, grabbed it, threw it in the hole. And I was like, oh. But this is the whole point of it. God allowed me to see that, and then opened the hole as wide as it could be, and I looked inside, and it was all of my stuff. Everything that I thought was important in my life that really shouldn't have been was all in there. Everything piled here, there, and it was, I get it. I understand. It's not about me. It's not about stuff. It's all about you. And so I'm out of the machine, this time goes on, and I was given a tour of the universe. It's pretty nice, it's beautiful, and goes way beyond what you see in the NASA films. The point of it all was that I could see what a glorified body is, I assume, capable of. Or just being shown the majesty of the creation. But the whole thing ended where myself and the invisible spirit with me, right, were over our planet. Beautiful, obviously. You've seen that on TV and all like that. But what happened was very unique, because from a distance out here, there was no hand. It was invisible. Started writing out prayers in script and reading them to me. And then prayers were coming out not only of the United States, but they were coming from places all around the world. And I thought, and these prayers were just incredible as he read them to me. And so I told him that I wanted to stay. He asked me why. And at the end of all of this, going through this purging, if you will, I saw the most beautiful painting of Kathy and our six kids. And I was like, I was shocked. I was so embarrassed, because I said, that's my why. And of course, I thought about my family, and I thought about doing all of this stuff. But then it was like the most authentic, I'm here for them. I want to be here for them, and how much that meant to me. And it was almost like, and all of a sudden, they tell my wife that I have lungs, but I have to prove that I have a brain function. So there's an MRI involved, which they kept telling me of them, I was going to die. But here's the whole fun part of it. The the sign that they put up at the ICU saying that we proclaim that Gary will receive his lungs on March 20th, 2014. Well, the 20th came and went. They did not lose faith. They had a whole host of people outside of wherever the ICU was, and they're singing and they're playing guitars, and it was I guess sort of like a service, you know, if you will. And they just, midnight came and went, and they were still proclaiming that was a victory, right? So they came to my wife and the family on March 21st. I received my lungs. So it was great, you know, it was all cool. Well, after my surgery, I couldn't talk. I couldn't eat for, you know, 5 months, and I couldn't speak because my vocal folds were cattywampus, if you will. They were paralyzed in different positions. My esophagus was damaged. My diaphragm was damaged. My left arm was this way, and I had drop foot, and I was pretty much...
I remember seeing you.
Yeah, I was a mess.
2014?
Yeah.
You were, like, almost fresh out of the hospital.
Yeah, it was a hard comeback, but I really wanted to live. And that's while I'm in the coma, it's like I was like after that boom, I was like, I'm gonna live. I wanna live. I have to live. And I mean, I never wanted anything or fought internally, mentally so hard because I wanted to live. I knew I wanted to live, I knew why I wanted to live, and I had to live.
Wow.
And so I can't say a thing because I'm speechless. And when I could finally move, I'm lying here in the ICU, and the day I could move my thumb was kind of a red letter day. And then one day I moved my toes, and they have it on film. They go, show off, because I could move my toe. And my first walk, I think they let me sit up at about 2 weeks, and my first walk was like 8 feet. Then the next walk was like, I maybe made it 12, and then 22, and then 104, and then 400. I mean, it's like, I'm getting out of here, you know, which didn't happen right away.
Right, of
but
course.
I had to go through cognitive therapy and all kinds of vocal therapy and things like that. But get this, it's so fun. So after the transplant, the transplant team, UT Southwestern, the doctors down there, I mean, my goodness, they've done 600 lung transplants. They're just absolutely amazing. One of the doctors, Dr. Kaza, was in the area, and she was really tired. And I guess one of the kids asked her something, and she said, "Oh, don't listen to me. I've been up for like 2 days." And so, you know, that's all. Oh, wow, that's a long time, you know. And so then one of the kids went back and said, "Okay, you don't mind telling us why you were up so long?" And she goes, "Oh," she goes, "I was taking care of your father's lungs." And they go, "When did you know?" And she said, "Last night." That was March 20th, 2014. The lungs came on
surreal.
The 20th.
That's
so
surreal.
They didn't tell me that for months, but I was able to move my hands while I was in ICU and then put my up to my ears, and they were like, you know, they got the sign, they're pointing
right,
at things,
right.
And one of the kids finally said, "Are you telling us," I think it was Brittany, said, "Are you telling us you can hear prayers?" And I'm like, ding, 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 I can die now, you know, I got that off my chest. So enough of the reality of what I experienced and what I've been through pre and post-transplant have given me just a motivation and a heart for people. Our daughter had leukemia when she was 8 and then relapsed and had a bone marrow transplant. And what a fighter. I mean, faced her mortality at 8, and she's my hero. I mean, I model my survival in the hospital after her bravery, because it's definitely heroic. And, you know, there's all these people that they're just caught in life, and they're suffering. Maybe not from what happened to me, but there are so many. Life is suffering, actually.
Right.
And those who don't believe that, well, you know, you haven't lived long enough,
yeah.
I suppose. And it's how we deal with that. So, of course, I'm going to be sharing about how lung transplants work, how that system works, how to get on the organ list and things like that, what goes boom, you know, how to have an advocate there, because you can inadvertently be, you know, in harm's way if there's not somebody there as your as your ambassador, making sure that everything is done, you know, because things happen, you know, and nobody's fault. It's sometimes carelessness, it's just sometimes neglect, but things do happen. And so the book is just crafted in such a way that I get to tell my story, but I also get to provide hope and also just the ability to take what you've been given in life and work with it and do the absolute best you can. And along the way, just know that you're not alone. And we aren't alone, no matter what people say to the contrary, that there is a higher power, and that higher power is God, and God watches over each and every one of us, believer or not. And so I feel that it would be an injustice to that experience to just let it go
unnoticed.
Absolutely. Wow, what an incredible story.
Super powerful. Very powerful.
Wow.
I'm in the wow.
So, real quick, I know your story, this is just crazy. This whole story is just wow. So tell our audience, when are you anticipating, or what's the estimated date you're going to get this book? Because I know you're in the process of working on it. It takes time to get a book out. I know, because I've done one. It takes time to do all that. So when are you thinking you're going to get this out?
Well, this is a great embarrassment. You know, I'm 6 years.
It's not embarrassing.
I'm 6 years out, right? You know? Yeah. But the realism of doing this sometimes is I write about it and then I relive it.
Yes, absolutely.
And you know, that can be great, you know, but it can be off-putting, if you will. And it's also a matter of, I'm going through it to this day.
Right.
I mean, it wasn't just then and I walked away.
Yeah.
You know, I've had life-ending viruses multiple times where they go, well, you know, if this doesn't work, you'll be dead in 5 days. And things like that. I can't tell you how many thousands and thousands of hours in clinic and the blood test and the scans and the this and the that. And I was just thinking a moment ago, well, I could share, how many pills do you think I've taken since I came out of this whole thing when I went home? I estimated probably over 35,000. Because I take a battery, a box this big, I make 2 weeks at a time, and it's just loaded with medicine. So
it's like a dump truck.
I'm immunocompromised. I take so many drugs to keep my lungs in my body and I take, you know, viral medications. I take breathing viral treatments, and you know, so you trade one disease for another.
Sure.
Because all of this can have an effect on you and your physicality. But, you know, I'm here. And it's what I wanted. And I want to tell my story, and my book is in process. So thanks for giving me a pass on the timeline. I wish other people would. But
Get the book out.
It's 14 chapters, and I think it'll end up around 350 pages. And I've written a great deal. I mean, there's enough to do a book,
right
now. And so, I mean, every chance I get to think about it, I either write or I do something on the phone.
Sure.
I wake up in the middle of the night and I'll talk for an hour or two, you know.
Yeah.
So I'm really motivated. I think one day earlier this week, I wrote for 5 hours and we got a lot done. But to answer your question and not sound like I'm dodging it, is that I think that I'll have everything written that can be edited and dealt with, and you know, you've published books, so you know what I mean. By my goal, and I will do it by Christmas.
Okay.
So
we're gonna hold you to it then.
We will.
Julia will. I'll be like, hey, ask him, did he finish his book? So
thanks.
It's awesome. Well, your story is definitely remarkable, and it's a story of survival and just wow.
And thank you for sharing. That's a true blessing.
Well, thank you for having me. I love you. We've known each other for a long, long time.
Thank you.
You know, I met new friends today. Mm-hmm. And and your guest earlier, you know, you know, I think she's really cool. Thank you. This has been a lot of fun. I haven't done a podcast or anything yet, but you've inspired me to start doing that. I do have a Facebook page called about my situation. It's called Waiting to Live Story. And so my name is Gary Toll. It's spelled G-A-R-Y-T-O-L-E. It might come up or whatever. But you can go to Facebook and you can look at it. And I'm going to, with your permission,
please do.
I'll post this.
And
if you all have any questions about my story, or if you're facing something right now that could be very trying, whether it be illness related or might just simply be something that's happening in your life or the lives of those you love, do feel free. Just, maybe write something, ask, and I will do my very best to answer that to you and or point you in the right direction.
Because you are definitely a great person to talk to. Absolutely.
Thanks.
Absolutely.
Well, y'all have a great afternoon.
Yeah. Thanks for sharing your story with us and being a fighter.
Thanks.
And thank you to our viewers. This is As Real As They Come, Dallas. Please like, subscribe, and comment on our story. Love you.
Take care.